security and economy, these are the two keywords for President 박근혜's first overseas trip this year, the fourth year of her five-year term. The nuclear security summit in Washington, D.C., and her visit to Mexico. We'll talk about the results and significance today, right here in this program, Upfront.
The fourth nuclear security summit was held amid the rising concerns over nuclear security, along with the North's fourth nuclear test, as well as the missile launches. State leaders from 52 countries and representatives from four international organizations have shared opinions on the progress made in the field of nuclear issues and discussed ways to strengthen global security. President Park Geun-hye delivered a speech at a working luncheon and suggested three major strategies to maintain the nuclear security cooperation. By emphasizing the seriousness of the continuing nuclear threat of North Korea, President Park has focused on attracting more active participation from the international community in implementing North Korea's sanctions. The president has put stronger pressure on the North by having a series of summit talks with the U.S., China, and Japan. President Park has had a hectic schedule during her visit to promote her diplomatic strategy to deal with the North Korean nuclear issue. By going through four rounds of back-to-back summits, Korea-U.S., Korea-U.S.-Japan, Korea-Japan, and Korea-China talks, President Park has had in-depth discussions on North Korea's sanctions. President Park Geun-hye has also emphasized her strong will to take a leading role in promoting global cooperation to build up nuclear security regime.
미국에 이어 2차 핵안보 정상회의를 개최했던 우리는 이번으로 종료되는 핵안보 정상회의의 후속 과정에서 핵안보 레짐을 더욱 발전시켜 나가는데 주도적으로 기여하고자 합니다.
This year's nuclear security summit has been the final one, and the IAEA, the International Atomic Energy Agency, will replace its role by holding minister-level conferences. Korea will play a leading role in the international cooperation on nuclear security by serving as chair of the IAEA Nuclear Security Conference, which is going to be held in December. The international community has reconfirmed its will to boost cooperation for North Korea's sanctions on this year's Nuclear Security Summit. Strengthened global security cooperation is expected to impose stronger pressure on the North in the near future.
Well, for today's discussion, we have Professor Kim Tae-hyun, the Professor of International Relations from Chung-Ang University, joining us. Thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you.
And also, we have Global Affairs Specialist, Attorney Kim Young-joon. He is a Managing Director, Managing Partner of the international law firm Milbank. Thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you.
Okay, we have quite an interesting topic to talk about here. Let's start with the fourth nuclear security summit that took place in Washington, D.C., where President Park Geun-hye participated as one of the main key participants. Okay, talking about the nuclear security summit, what I remember and what many of our viewers who are joining from all around the world here will remember is this is kind of like President Obama's brainchild, right?
Yeah, right.
During the early part of his presidency, he proposed the idea of the world without nuclear weapons, and as a result of it, a lot of people believe he got the Nobel Peace Prize. And since then, many things have been happening. But overall, let's start with a very broad observation or broad assessment of this concept called this multilateral gathering nuclear security summit. Why is this important? And particularly, why is this fourth gathering important? Professor Kim?
Yes, yeah, so as you said, this is a brainchild of President Obama. Mm-hmm. And this is his last term, so mm-hmm. it's a biennial conferences. So I mean, start his term. Mm-hmm. He served two terms for 4 years. Mm-hmm. Biennial makes it fourth.
Okay.
And so they expect that after this fourth summit, mm-hmm. there is ministerial level cooperation will continue to get back this kind of agenda alive for the future.
Ministerial conference, meaning under the auspice of IAEA, I suppose, International Atomic Energy Agency. So the form will be very different. But this fourth gathering here, I'm sure they were talking about, I mean, we know that they talked about North Korean nuclear issue here, but also there were other concerns and issues, right, Mr. Kim?
Yes, there have been big changes since the last summit, and particularly in the nuclear deal with Iran. Some say it's a big progress, particularly Israel, and others, particularly Israel and some Middle Eastern neighbors of Iran, think it's a bit bad deal. But because of that, Iran was not invited to summit. Presumably, it's still being tested in terms of compliance with the the deal. Also, Russia, together with the United States, controlled 90% of nuclear missile stockpile, and Russia obviously is boycotting it, thinking that IAEA is the proper forum. But having said that, I think in addition to international technocratic or bureaucratic agency, IAEA, having a multilateral summit focusing on this issue is a very important initiative with or without Russia's participation. So in that regard, I think it leaves a good legacy for President Obama.
Talking about legacy for President Obama, this is more like a facade of his initiative of nuclear world without nuclear weapons. Right. But in terms of the actual substantive gain, I think you have indicated perhaps the deal with Iran could be one. And I suppose the lack of progress with North Korea could be a liability here as a whole. But the looking back the 8 years here, 2010 was the first nuclear summit.
Right.
And then, as you mentioned, Professor Kim, biannual. So 2012, we clearly remember we had
we hosted
second nuclear summit here. And then the last one was 2014, Hague, Netherlands. What do you remember in terms of the achievements or significance that have been produced at each step of the way? I mean, it's difficult for us to go back all the way 8 years, but any progress that
see? Nuclear Secret Summit is not to replace any existing non-proliferation regime. It's intent to supplement it. Okay, so non-security regime based on NPT, non-proliferation treaty, and IAEA is designed to, on the promise of nuclear disarmament by the head states, and they will work not to proliferate those nuclear weapons to non-weapon states, and then promote the peaceful use of nuclear energy. That is important part. Particularly, peaceful use of nuclear energy is very important. But the problem is, believing that nuclear weapon states are kind of responsible hold over nuclear materials, but what if they are released to non-responsible members like terrorists? Then it's going to be a big disaster. So it's intended to prevent those nuclear materials and nuclear technology going into the hands of nuclear terrorists or non-state actors. And then you remember that in 2011, there was a kind of accident in Japan, Fukushima. So it's a nuclear security means securing it from the hands of terrorists. Now, new agenda, that nuclear safety, is also emerged. So combined with existing mechanism safeguarding, those preventing the conversion of civilian purpose nuclear energies into weapons program, that safeguards, then this is security and safety. Those three S's, they say, are new agenda in this non-proliferation regime.
I think that's very interesting and a clear layout of the overall structure of this international regime that's being added by Nuclear Security Summit. Then what Professor Kim said is basically NPT, the way I understand, Mr. Kim, NPT and IAEA, these are more about the countries, state actors, what they're supposed to do and what they're not supposed not to. And then what the Nuclear Security Summit brings in is measures to control or manage the non-state actors, a little bit greater emphasis on that, right? Preventing the misuse of this kind of nuclear materials and so on. Is that fair observation?
Yeah, I think the significance of this Nuclear Security Summit is beyond IAEA basically enforcing the international treaty. Many people, certainly state actors and civilians, thought, well, that was for some specialists, not really general interest to the world. But the significance of the first summit was actually declaring the urgency of the situation, the message being shared by and declared by the global leaders. That was the first summit's most important is urgency of the issue. Number two, a second summit basically brought in more details as to how do we move forward, following on the Washington work plan adopted in the first summit, which included, for example, dirty bomb, not necessarily a serious nuclear materials, but it is a serious issue for terrorism.
What's the concept of dirty bomb for the sake of the interest
dirty
of
bomb viewers? Is a low-level radioactive material that can be basically stolen by the terrorists and non-state actors that can be used as a huge threat for society.
I understand they're talking about using drones to spread the nuclear material that terrorists could actually obtain from academia or hospitals, and then, you know, as I said, put them on the drone and then just spread them around. And they say like 10 gram of nuclear material could kill so many people altogether.
Yeah, but there have been so many speculations about how bad things can be, but knock on wood, such things haven't happened yet. But just finish the thought. The third summit basically brought about promotion of transparency and disclosure information
to the
citizenry.
Yeah.
That's right. So in that vein, basically, United States unilaterally disclosed the fact that they have reduced their nuclear stockpile by 20% since 1996, and that level of information disclosure hasn't happened in 15 years. So again, the United States is trying to lead the world in terms of, you know, being transparent and educating the public about this issue.
Professor Kim, we have already touched upon the fact that Russia didn't participate this time, and then after this fourth summit, as you mentioned, there will be no longer a nuclear security summit at the summit level, but it will be ministerial gatherings under the auspice of IAEA. Would you expect the overall topics to be discussed under the new format of ministerial level be different? And what do you see in terms of overall direction of this nuclear discussion from this point on?
I mean, the nations made a committee to the work plans, and then submitting their progress report to the. So now IAEA will still play the central role, and the summit meetings set the agenda and made the momentum for that. And then those ministerial level conferences will check the progresses. So as long as terrorist threat from the terrorists remains, like we observe IS and so on, and the commitment to that kind of issue is remains strong. You know, the global governance pattern has changed a little bit in the recent years. So like summit meetings, multilateral summit meetings has been an important forum for global global governance, like G20 is an example. And U.S. Secret Summit is another example. They can big summits or a climate change summit in Paris, or those kind of things will set the agenda and make momentum. And each and every national government follows on. Of course, the leadership is very important. So if President Obama is replaced by someone who does not share his commitment to this issue, then it may lose a little bit of momentum. But once the bureaucratic or institutional agenda is set, I think it may go on.
I think Professor Kim made a very important point. IAEA is not an organization that can actually lead and set the agenda. Right. It actually implements and monitors and advises state actors based on an agreed framework. Presumably, it's decided by the sovereign actors.
It's more like implementation hand.
Correct. So the essential need for carrying this initiative on is really the global leaders continue to have interest. Assuming, let's say, you know, Hillary Clinton becomes president, and you know, she will definitely be carrying on the same message. But my view, her sort of political orientation is more based on political realism than political idealism as opposed to President Obama.
I see.
So she might have a slightly different priorities in terms of pushing the agenda. But in terms of what would be important is that this established goal is permeating through the IAEA level. But that's going to be a little bit of a challenge.
Sounds like a fair observation there. And I guess we do not want to spend time on Trump's scenario here when he becomes president.
Which is why I completely ignore that topic.
Exactly. Talking about individuals, President Park Geun-hye, as one of the important participants in this summit meeting this time, dealing with 52 different countries, and especially as an owner of this issue called North Korean nuclear threat, what do we see in terms of her activities and participation?
She said it clearly that the world without nuclear weapons should start with the Korean Peninsula without nuclear weapons. Mm-hmm. I mean, the most outstanding and challenging issue is North Korea's continuing provocative actions mm-hmm. with respect to nuclear weapons as well as its delivery system, that's the missiles. Mm-hmm. And she clearly said that her vision mm-hmm. as a president is to establish peaceful unification of Korean Peninsula right. as a way to achieve Korean Peninsula without nuclear weapons. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, at the Multilateral Forum, I mean, she shared the vision mm-hmm. of a world without nuclear weapons, and on the sidelines, she had met many summits mm-hmm. at the both bilateral and multilateral setting to push ahead right. her agenda on mm-hmm. that. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right. Talking about bilateral summits, we will talk about more of the details there. But after this interview with our expert, and then we will continue on about these different bilateral meetings that she was holding on April 1st, Korea time, before her active participation of April 2nd into this summit meeting. So we will continue on that discussion after this interview.
Along with the, on the issue of North Korea and also on U.S. policy toward China, the future U.S.-Japan-Korea trilateral cooperation, I think, will be much more solid and stronger. Now, U.S. is getting ready to have more assertive and more strong policy towards China. Now, the U.S. capability is getting better, and China is, economy is receding. So I think U.S. is thinking that this is a very good opportunity to check the rise of China. So I think in this sense, U.S.-Japan-Korea trilateral cooperation will be much more solid. And also this will be applied to the North Korea issues. China, vis-a-vis the trilateral, coordination, I think wants to bring North Korea into dialogue as soon as possible. And in this sense, if a sanction phase ends in 2 or 3 months, China and other three countries, their opinions and policies towards North Korea will be different. One thing we have to take note of is that, after there was a negative response by the United States, North Korea proposed again the importance of peace regime talk, and they denied the possibility of denuclearization. They instead wanted the peace regime talk instead of nuclear talk. So I think this means that the dialogue can change into the benefit of North Korea. And but this time the U.S. and South Korea is very adamant. They want to pursue sanctions. They want to pursue sanctions so that this time the dialogue should be really serious and sincere. So this is just a beginning of sanctions phase, and this kinds of dialogue proposed by North Korea, I don't think this makes sense at all.
Okay, all right, so it's time now we have to move on to her overall bilateral meetings here, the April 1st Korean time. And she has had a tough schedule, starting from 10 a.m. until 6 p.m., running almost whole day, meeting with different heads of the states. Overall observation, Mr. Kim, the way you see it, what do you see in terms of the results and the achievements?
First of all, I think the President Park was quite lucky in terms of fortuitous timing mm-hmm. because of the international sanctions on North Korea and the North Korea nuclear test being fresh on everybody's mind.
January nuclear test, and then the missile launch February, and then the UN Security Council resolution coming out 2270 March. So this
right.
is perfect timing.
Yeah, and the right. continuing international defiance of international sanctions. So. Right. this topic was fresh on all the leaders' minds, so she didn't have to bring up and explain any of the issues. The challenge was there. It was her job to basically make sure everybody's on the same page in terms of international need for containing North Korea on this point. So she's been very fortunate in that regard. Clearly, especially given the nature of the forum, there was no credible world leader who was showing any sympathy on the North Korean side. So ironically, perhaps that probably gives the Kim Jong-un regime the needed narrative as to why North needs this, because the internal narrative might be, see, we are surrounded by enemies, we have no friends. But be that as it may, it will not have a material impact in terms of any behavioral change on the North part in the immediate future. But there is an international consensus that this needs to be continued.
Solidifying the base upon which we can press ahead with the UNSCR 2270, I suppose, in that regard. Let's move on to the bilateral meetings. The first that bilateral meeting that took place during her bilateral day was Korea-U.S. summit. The length of it was 15 minutes. There were different discussion, Professor Kim, why the meeting was itself was short. Some people have said that's all because since ever since January, when we have so much going on between Pyongyang and then our side here, the discussion between Seoul and Washington has been almost real-time basis, right? So 15 minutes of the meeting, what do we get out of that?
I mean, 50 minutes is not short, given that there are 52 summits from all around the world.
That's true.
Obama shared, I mean, shared his very time with others as well. So 50 minutes is also important. I think that what is the most important at this moment, you know, North Koreans keep challenging it, and from North Korea's perspective, it's the United States who are primary target of the actions. So they want to send a message to that. And but in the middle, what is really threatened is South Korea. And the Korean people is very concerned about North Korea's challenges, threats, and U.S.-Korean alliances. And we are relying on United States for nuclear umbrella and other measures, alliance to deter North Korea and defend South Korea. That is a key important issue, and President Obama showed, I mean, his 15 minutes very important. Again, then added up three trilateral conference summit as well. So I think that showed the U.S. commitment to resolve this issue, pay attention to this issue. I mean, the last summit meeting with bilateral summit, they say that there's the utmost urgency. I mean, they agree that, and it's special communique about the North Korean nuclear issues. So, I mean, that shows that the commitment.
Right. And from 15-minute bilateral meeting with Obama, President Park Geun-hye moved on to the trilateral meeting you mentioned, which was about, according to our calculation, 75 minutes trilateral meeting between Abe and Park Geun-hye and Obama. Of course, the topic we can guess was North Korean nuclear issue, must been on the top of the agenda. Mr. Kim, your observation about the outcome overall interpretation of the this gathering?
You mean regarding the Korea-U.S.-Japan trilateral
summit? Right, your observation. Right.
Obviously, just touching on the bilateral U.S.-Korea talk first, you know, the summit, as Professor Kim mentioned, was not expected to break any new ground. It's a continuing dialogue, confirming the alliance, confirming that we all share the same objective. As far as the tripartite summit among Korea, U.S., Japanese leaders, it is a one useful forum enabled by this multilateral gathering, because the bilateral gathering, particularly between Korea and Japan, is so difficult and hard to arrange. But using this multilateral forum, arranging this three-party summit is a much easier thing to do and desirable thing to do. So the three strategic allies of Northeast Asia have reaffirmed their commitment to strengthening the alliance and the but with Korea being a bit wary of the Abe government's aggressive venture into a military outreach.
And history issues and all these tensions.
Presumably, President Obama will have assuaged the Korean concern about that aspect of Japanese venture. So it'll have been Korea airing its concerns about Japan, U.S. trying to assuage Korean concern. Don't worry about it, we're all in this together. And then strategically, as all three allies together, we're here to sort of build as a bulwark for potential Chinese projection into the territory too much.
Professor Kim, a little bit more on that trilateral meeting. What's your observation? I mean, this, in my recollection, this was the first trilateral meeting in the last 2 years or so. I think last time, I may be wrong about this, but last time they got together was Hague, or I don't know, that's my recollection. But you know, when they get together, a lot of this trilateral cooperation for security in the face of North Korean nuclear weapon, I suppose that's what they were focusing on, I suppose, right?
You know, I mean, from the U.S. perspective, Japan and Korea, two very important allies,
right,
together with the United States, they will form a triangle.
Mm-hmm.
But whenever the bilateral relationship between the United States and Korea and Japan is not good, the triangle is not complete.
Right.
So United States, it was the United States who urged to normalize diplomatic relations in 1965, and the same, they shared the same concern. Without complete triangle, the Asia strategy, particularly in the face of rising China and so on, is not complete. So the United States really urged to try to work very hard to bridge the difference between two countries. But fortunately, this time, in December, Japan and Korea reached an agreement about those comfortable urban issues.
Right.
So, I mean, this is a new chapter. So, I think, I mean, United States urged to, let's say, was it a military intelligence agreement with Japan?
Right,
but at this moment, Korea did not quite agree to that. But it will be on agenda in coming diplomatic effort by bilateral. So in such a way, I mean, the general spirit for cooperation continue. But three of us really share one urgent issue. That is North Korean nuclear challenge. It is ongoing, and it will be gets more serious as the days go on. And three of those countries have means to do something, something about North Korea, particularly through sanctions. So we will discuss sanctions later, but sanctions at this time is very important.
And
without close coordination between three allies, it won't be very effective.
Based on the United Nations Security Council resolution, all these countries are making their moves, and especially Japan and the United States and Korea being the main movers, coordination is very important, obviously, right? Moving on to the next meeting that President Bakune had following the trilateral meeting, that was the Korea-Japan bilateral summit. The length was 25 minutes, 10 minutes longer than the bilateral summit with Obama. I can guess, Professor Kim, let's continue with you on this, because you've been talking about Japan issues here in this program and elsewhere as well. Would you say the December 28th agreement between Tokyo and Korea and implementation of it, regarding the sex slavery issue during the imperial time, do you think that was the main topic?
I mean, the follow-up issues, I guess, I think. So, you see, many experts at the points of agreement was made, they said, oh, that was a good deal, but the public opinion in Korea was not favorable to that. So I think President Bakune may have felt something to calm down those kind of public displeasure with that. So I think that she must have urged some kind of concrete implementation, or
and perhaps more importantly, Japan has taken actions to can I say this, violate the spirit of the agreement, meaning that, you know, there will be no reversal or backstep here, but Japan has done, some of their ministers and key government officials have said or expressed positions that seem to kind of roll the clock back. I'm sure President Bakune had enough of grievances and the problems that she wanted to raise, I suppose. Okay, anyway, we have to cover other issues here. That is, perhaps in the eyes of some of the observers, a very important meeting that took place for the first time after North Korea's fourth nuclear test, that is the summit between Bakune and Xi Jinping. It was the longest of her meeting, any meeting that she had there in Washington, D.C., 80 minutes. What is our observation? Of course, the THAAD, the terminal, high altitude, the missile defense probably was one of the issues, and of course, all the sanctions and all that. I'm sure the plate was full, Mr. Kim. What's your observation?
Yeah, I think during the early parts of the President Park's presidency, I think she was focused on how to potentially positively reset the Korea-China relationship, taking advantage of new emergence of President Xi Jinping and her, I think, general popularity in China, being regarded as a China-friendly person and all that. So in that perspective, during the first couple of years, I think she focused probably a little too much on China, kind of forgetting the importance of U.S.-China relationship. But as I mentioned earlier, she did a great job in balancing those two sort of acts in terms of, you know, making sure we're on the same page with China for the most part, and making sure we're, you know, firmly within the Korea-U.S. alliance.
And that was until up to last January. And ever since the nuclear test, there have been a lot of different perspectives and views came
out, so it, in a way, is a kind of wake-up call as to what the true reality long-term on this Korean peninsula is.
Indeed.
When push comes to shove, it's not going to be China who's going to be looking after South Korean interests as opposed to the United States.
Right. Since January.
So, but it shouldn't come as a big surprise. So.
And so it was, would you say it was a kind of fine-tuning or the tuning once again?
I would say the two leaders probably agreed to disagree because each party understands the other side's position, why they cannot agree to the other side. So in that sense, given the general friendly nature of the overall relationship between Korea and China, probably it was more like agree to disagree, but let's focus on areas where we agree, which is enforcing the international sanction against North Korea and so forth. But let's not push too much on this thought and other issues, but let each party say what they need to say.
Okay, we have discussed a lot about the this bilateral diplomacy and the discussions about nuclear issues during our first part of this discussion today. And it's time to move on to President Park Geun-hye's bilateral diplomacy south of the border in Mexico. And we will do that right after this.
President Park headed to Mexico after attending the Nuclear Security Summit in Washington. It was the first bilateral summit with Mexico since she took office, and the president has focused on boosting economic cooperation. Mexico is the second biggest market in Latin America after Brazil, and it is located in a strategic position as it borders on the U.S., which is the top commercial partner in North America.
By strengthening economic cooperation with Mexico, which is a country that has had a wide range of FTAs, we can expand opportunities to use Mexico as export outposts to make inroads into the U.S. and Latin American markets.
Local media in Mexico has especially shown a great interest in the Korea-Mexico FTA. By putting an interview with President Park, the media has attracted high expectations on the possible benefits the two countries can get through the bilateral FTA. As the first scheduled item on her itinerary in Mexico, President Park had a dinner with representatives from the Korean community in Mexico. The president expressed her gratitude to the Korean community and asked them to play a bridging role for the development of Korea-Mexico bilateral relations.
든든한 가교 역할을 해주신다면 더욱 가까운 이웃으로 함께 발전할 수 있습니다. 항상 대한민국을 가슴에 간직하고 열심히 뛰어주시기 바랍니다. 멕시코를 비롯한 국제사회가 우리의 대북 정책과 통일 노력을 더욱 강력하게 지지할 수 있도록 성원해 주시기를 바랍니다.
President Park has revved up her sales diplomacy drive on the bilateral summit with the Mexican president. Korea and Mexico signed MOUs on Korea's advancement into the Mexican infrastructure market and strengthening cooperation on the emerging industries like energy, health, and medical care, as well as culture. And the two leaders also agreed to hold a working-level meeting in the fourth quarter of this year in order to resume Korea-Mexico FTA talks, which has been stalled since 2008.
Mexico는 우리의 중남미 지역 최대 교역국이지만 양국 간 교역 및 투자를 확대해 나갈 여지는 여전히 매우 크다고 봅니다. 이런 측면에서 양국 간 FTA 협의 개시와 한국의 TPP 가입 시 멕시코의 지지 방안 등을 논의하기 위해 금년 4분기 중 실무 협의를 개최키로 합의한 것을 뜻깊게 생각합니다.
624 domestic companies, including Samsung, LG, and POSCO, have advanced into the Mexican market. President Park's visit to Mexico is expected to boost the bilateral trade between the two countries and also play a bridging role for Korea when it comes to the country's advancement into the American region.
Okay, now time to discuss President Park Geun-hye's summit diplomacy in Central Asia, I suppose we have to say, or the south part of the Washington, where she spends considerable amount of time and she moved on. And Mexico is a very important country, of course, for South Korea, especially with particular reference to this region. So let's talk about what she had to do there and achievements and then, you know, all the significances of the action that we see. First of all, Mr. Kim, the Korea-Mexico, we remember Mexico has been always with Korea since the beginning of the establishment of this republic here. A lot of help and goodwill building, and I guess Koreans moving there, you know, emigrating to that country and so on. How should we look back for the past several decades of the bilateral relationship between Mexico and Korea?
Yeah, as you mentioned, the Korea-Mexico relations have been always very positive, and only increasingly so. Even before the economic reforms pursued by the current president, Nieto, Korean business has been quite active in Mexico. You mentioned migration, I think there are about 12 to 15,000 Koreans who are making Mexico their home. Mm-hmm. In my personal field of project development finance, actually I have personally worked on a number of Mexican projects, such as helping Korean companies do major refurbishment works for the refinery plants for Pemex, the national oil company, mm-hmm. as well as building power plants developed with participation from Korea Electric Power Corporation, mm-hmm. LNG terminals built by Samsung and so forth. Mm-hmm. Korean companies are regarded very highly in Mexico, and therefore also export credit agencies such as Korea Export Import Bank have been very supportive of Korean companies going into Mexico. I think with President Nieto getting really hard remarks for having done very difficult economic reform, I think it should create more opportunities for Korean companies.
Mexico's importance to Korea, Mr. Kim has already mentioned, very big picture here. What I remember is ever since the 80s, I suppose, when the idea of NAFTA first was raised, Korea has been continuously talking about Mexico being important as a kind of bridge or the way into American market. Does the picture remain still the same? I guess Mr. Kim has mentioned or indicated some different possibilities. What do we see in terms of the importance of Mexico? Just the gateway into U.S. market?
Only? Of course, it remains so.
It is. I mean,
you know, the labor cost in Mexico is still relatively low, so we can use Mexico as a kind of export basis to the United States and the rest of the American continent.
Right.
But there one addition to that, I think two additions. One is that the Trans-Pacific Partnership, TPP.
Right.
I mean, Korea missed that point, thinking that we already has many bilateral FTAs with those member states. But later it turns out that TPP has become very high quality free trade agreement, that a new level is what is called mega FTA. So Korea is now intended to join it later, but Mexico is already in there, and we need Mexico's approval to get in there. So that is one important part.
Strategic assistance or partnership to help Korea's entry into there.
Yeah. Okay. Another one is like MITA. You know, I mean, Korea's global diplomatic agenda has been middle power diplomacy. And since 2013, we formed what is called MITA, Mexico, Indonesia, Korea, Turkey, and Australia. Kind of active multilateral diplomacy for it, and Mexico is part of it. So, you know, Mexico is very similar with Korea in terms of the size of economy and the diplomatic roles. And so, I mean, it's a very natural partnership. So, TPP and MICTA will add up the importance of Mexico to our diplomatic horizons.
Well, what's the issue scope that MICTA is supposed to cover? Is it does it cover all the economic as well as security issues?
Yeah, security issues as well. Yes, it covers a lot of it. I mean, it started. As the five countries within the G20 context.
As the middle powers.
Yeah, middle powers in the level of the size as well as the level of economic development. So it links between developed countries and developing countries. But at the same time, on important issues like terrorist issues and so on, it has issued a common statement. So it has broadened up to other areas as well.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Kim, in a bilateral summit meeting between Park Geun-hye and President Nieto, we heard the North Korean nuclear issue was discussed, and we understand Mexico is making its move in terms of implementing the UNSCR, United Nations Security Council Resolution 2270, into action, recently getting hold of North Korean vessels and so on. What do you see in terms of the cooperation on this front, North Korean nuclear issues? Is there a big important role we see on the part of Mexico being situated in that part of the world in terms of dealing with or helping Korea with regard to North Korean nuclear issues?
Right. I personally don't see any obvious strategic importance of Mexico in dealing with North Korea, but obviously Mexico is clearly within the sphere of influence of the United States and also has a very close relationship and friendly relationship with Korea. So Mexico is clearly supportive of the U.S.-led and international community-led sanctions and has no reason not to be. And so it is natural for Mexico to follow through in implementation. So it's just it shouldn't give Mexico any second thought as to even consider why they wouldn't. So it is a natural thing for them to do.
Right.
But
right.
I wouldn't necessarily pay too much strategic importance as to because Mexico supports us, it gives us any particular advantage one way
right.
or the other. Yeah.
Right. I guess that is the reason why we need to move on to the points of President Park Geun-hye's economic diplomacy,
right.
where she put in a lot of efforts. So we will continue on with that discussion. Talking about President Park Geun-hye's economic diplomacy or business diplomacy, they said the business delegation that she brought to Mexico this time was the biggest ever regarding, in terms of presidential, trip to that particular country. 145 people this time she brought with her. From your experience on the front lines, bringing this huge business delegation, does it really make a big difference?
Well. As I mentioned in some previous occasions, yeah, that is true. The size of such delegation, does matter, but it really doesn't necessarily dictate the results coming from such visit. But
right.
But certainly shows a strong interest. So, as a light aside, our society is so obsessed with ranking generally, so metrics. So always measures two people more when,
numbers.
Three people less when. Right. We put too much emphasis on that. So
right.
I think it also probably indirectly shows not only a strong positive interest in Mexico, but also in a negative way shows the dearth of other opportunities around the world. So they're really desperate for looking for new opportunities to expand business around the world. So they're trying to really, turn all those stones unturned.
Right.
Having said that, like Kia Motors, for example, they invested multi-billion-dollar in a state-of-the-art plant in the state of Georgia in the southern United States. And one of the southern states in the United States was hoping for additional investment from Kia, but Kia considered many alternatives. But last year, they decided to spend $1.3 billion in building a plant in Monterrey, Mexico, which is a very significant move, it's telling. So in addition to using Mexico as a platform or springboard into North America itself, but it's actually using Mexico as a platform or springboard for the rest of the world, because Mexico is one of the most active trading countries around the world. They have, depending on how you count it, if you count all 28 or 29 members of EU, Mexico has something like dozen FTAs and involving 45 plus countries. So it is not just Americas, but it's really the global market that Mexico is very well suited for using as springboard, because they have a very relatively low wage but very highly skilled labor, very strong manufacturing sector, so which goes very well with the Korean companies invest.
I guess the cooperation, business cooperation, goes well beyond just auto parts, but the healthcare industries and energy sectors and also even retails. Those are important, and they're important because Korea's perspective on Mexico as the FTA hub. What do we see in terms of Mexico's position? I mean, we've been hearing enough about Mexico being an important country, as I mentioned before, in the setting of NAFTA. But Mexico's other FTAs with other parts, other countries in the region, is it still important consideration that Korea has in being in seeing Mexico here?
I mean, just before to say that, I was in Georgia at Radala just 2 weeks ago.
Please.
And there is a Kia. Right. I heard from our consulates that Kia having difficulty in securing high quality laborers because those experienced automakers are in the state of Michigan, not in Georgia.
So
that's why they're moving to the Mexico in that regard. And in addition to that, yes, Mexico has been a hub for, just like we, a lot of bilateral as well as multilateral FTAs. And it's highly experienced with the export and so on. So we, Mr. Kim just mentioned there are dearth of opportunities. And they are talking about Mexico as an opportunity area. Iran is newly opening market. Myanmar is another newly one. That is all looking for. So I mean, Myanmar has a dozen FTA plus with 40 some member countries still provide together with skilled laborers and cheap labor cost.
Interesting.
That is opening up the new opportunity for Korean businesses.
Talking about free trade, you already have touched upon, Professor Kim, the TPP issue here. Okay, what in terms of what Korea faces, in terms of challenge ahead, Korea is actively talking with, I suppose, Washington and also Tokyo. But side support from Mexico, a lot of people believe, would be very important. What kind of things can we expect from Mexico in this regard? Can we persuade Mexico as an exceptional member that could be even more active than others in terms of supporting Korea's accession to the TPP at this stage? What do you see in terms of like the scenarios ahead in terms of Mexico's rule and role as well as other countries' opposition or welcoming of Korea's accession in terms of the focusing on issue of Korea's joining TPP ahead?
I think that the most important is, of course, the United States. United States is the anchor state, I mean, made the TPP possible in the first place.
Right.
United States has, I think, two observations on Korea. On one hand, in the U.S. side, they are not happy with the bilateral FTA with the United States. They say South Korea is taking more advantage than the United States business does.
Right.
Another one, remember when the TPP was signed, President Obama said, we cannot let countries like China write the rules of international trade, something like that. That is strategic movement.
Right, right.
So United States are trying to, vis-a-vis China's effort to build RCEP, Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership and so on. United States is matching with TPP as a
kind of balancing.
And they cannot leave Korea out of it.
They
in this sense, that they should allow South Korea to join them. Without Korea being one of the largest trading countries in the world, TPP won't be complete. So that is a good side. Another side is that some in the U.S., I mean, the Trump and others, they think that the voters in the United States, I think they're losing their jobs because of international competition.
Right.
That is downside.
Right.
On that, I think Mexico can play an important role in the to push for the positive side.
Good summary of the overall picture there. Mr. Kim, let's focus more on the bilateral the deal or discussion on FTA. Of course, Korea and Mexico has had a long history, if you will. Some people have kind of like lost their patience in a way in terms of its pace of progress. I remember 2002 was the first time when there was an action doing something about Korea-Mexico FTA in the form of a joint study that began 2002. That's decades ago, now years ago, I suppose. And you have mentioned already, since 2008, the process has been stalled. So 6 years now. What do you see in terms of those people who may be interested in Korea-Mexico FTA getting materialized? Do we have a hope here? I'm sure the two heads of the states must have discussed the deal this time in Mexico City, but what do you see from as an outsider observer?
I also read at the end of 2015, around October, November, I think our foreign minister, Yoon, mentioned Korea's strong interest in reviving the FTA talk with Mexico when his counterpart from Mexico was also in the presence of some multilateral meeting in the Philippines, for example. But I haven't seen any reaction coming from Mexico, one way or the other. Mm-hmm. But
and you mentioned that's that has a lot to do with the domestic political opposition from
right.
Mexican mm-hmm. Mexican
that's
business.
Right. Yeah. Okay. But with President Nieto, again, I put more hope in sort of weighing the economic costs and benefits, and overall there will be mutual benefits for having Korea-Mexico free trade deal. Mm. But at the end of the day, it really is about each country's benefits as opposed to having a friendly leader. It really is a cold calculation of what does it mean for our country and their country and so forth. So
give and take.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. So, but it'll be a good forum to raise this, and a very timely topic for the two leaders at this time. Mm.
So basically, we'll have to wait and see what comes out of the possible discussion in Mexico City between the two leaders about the bilateral, the trade talk, I suppose. Okay, I guess we are getting closer to time to wrap up this discussion. Professor Kim, how would you evaluate overall the bilateral diplomacy or presidential diplomacy in Mexico this time? President Park was busy doing all these mm-hmm. cultural events and then business events and as well as political summit and so on. What is your evaluation about what happened this time, and what do you see ahead as a result of that?
No. Korea has a kind of international society. Korea has a strange identity. On one hand, mm-hmm. it is global identity. Mm-hmm. We have pursued, well, you remember the motto of global Korea
right.
during the past president, and now there's middle power diplomacy seeking mm-hmm. all over the world. Mm-hmm. And so she is playing that kind of role by attending such a multilateral conference like a Yugoslavic summit. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, Korea's foreign diplomatic focus is also North Korea, managing its bilateral relations, meeting North Korea challenge on that.
Right.
So this is an area where two concerns are met. Mm. On one hand, Korea is a global power or middle power. On the other hand, Korea is one of the countries that has most urgent and dire security challenges. So she has been doing her job on that. I hope that she got most out of those economic summits with Mexico as well.
Mm. Okay, I see. And Mr. Kim, your observation of overall efforts that has been made in Mexico as a result of her visit, what do you see?
Right, as you mentioned earlier, for a summit, whether it's bilateral, multilateral, to happen, mm-hmm. there has to be lots of below the surface work
right.
that must take place between the various working level and higher level, ministry level, all sorts of levels of discussions. Mm-hmm. So in brief, you cannot expect just a huge breakthrough from just spending 2-3 days together. But mm-hmm. President Park's attendance at the Nuclear Security Summit was a fortuitously timely event in the wake of the international sanctions on North Korea right. and North's continuing defiance of that sanctions mm-hmm. Regime. One can only hope that over time North will somehow accede to the reality surrounding it, but I'm not holding my breath too long, but there's that hope. As for the president's visit to Mexico, mm-hmm. it is also a timely one, highlighting Mexico's emergency as an important platform to project beyond Mexico's borders for international investors investing in that country in terms of FDI, foreign direct investment there. Mm-hmm. And it was a good initiative for the president to lead the delegation to look for these opportunities, especially when there are so few opportunities to make great investments around the world.
Okay, sounds good. Sounds like a wonderful wrap-up of our discussion that we have been having today. And I'm sure our viewers who have joined from countries like Mexico, and also those viewers who may be interested in North Korean nuclear issues, and particularly the cooperation of important powers around the Korean Peninsula, should have learned a lot of new perspective and interesting lessons from our discussion. That's particularly our hope. And for that reason, we really strongly urge you to come back to our program next time when we talk about these issues that matters for Korea as well as the world. And until then, this has been Kim Byung-joo, and goodbye.